You couldn't work with Ron without becoming attached to Ron. It just came with the territory. He was so engaging, he had the ability to draw you in, and you got connected. Our next speaker knows what I'm talking about. Ron and Jonathan Murray first met in 1998 at BAL's audition for the Closing Bell Report, a daily segment that has spanned for 14-plus years and led to a unique, special friendship. Ron called Jonathan his non-biological son, a phrase Ron didn't use all that often, which is probably a good thing, June. Ron and June, Jonathan and Jenny, also shared a very close relationship as couples. And Ron once said to Jonathan's wife, Jenny, "How do you live with someone who's so upbeat all the time?" June, I'll infer from that you did not have that same problem. Please welcome WBAL financial analyst and senior vice president at UBS, Jonathan Murray.
Wow, what a lead. I asked Mike Welbrock to play that music for us because for many of you, that was the signal that Ron's show was about to begin. You'd be driving in the Beltway, you'd hear that music and turn off your cell phone, turn back to the kids and say, hey, be quiet down there, and you'd turn up the volume. And Mike found it. By the way, Mike Welbrock, Mike, are you there? Raise your hand, Mike. Mike made all of this happen. Mike Welbrock started at WBAL in 1981, which is impossible because he looks like he's 20. June likes to say that she and Ron found Mike in a little basket on the Jones Falls and brought him up to TV Hill, and the rest was history. So yeah, coming out of the news at the top of the hour, you'd hear that guitar riff leading into Ron's show, and it was kind of like Pavlovian conditioning. You couldn't wait to hear what Ron was going to rant about, right? That must have been nice to have looked forward to that, because I, whenever I heard that music at 4:05 every single day, I was absolutely petrified. My stomach was churning, my leg would be jiggling, my throat would get so dry that Ron's producer, Ryan Bogash, would whisper into my headset, "Think of eating pickles." Pickles. Try that sometime if your throat gets dry. It's interesting. I was nervous because I had absolutely no idea what Ron was going to talk to me about, what he was going to throw at me that day. You know, I just wanted to say what the Dow did and maybe that McCormick Spices raised its dividend by 2 pennies. And the next thing you know, I'm having to defend the entire free market capitalist system against the massive printing presses in Washington, and they want to control you. And I'd say, yeah, but, you know, Ron, don't you like Procter & Gamble at 11 times earnings with a 4% dividend yield? Back then, I associated Ron kind of what Stan was saying, is a big, strong Marine, and he also had his DNA making him tough. He was a proud, strong Midwestern Norwegian who tended to keep his warm and fuzzies kind of to himself. You've heard Ron mention his Danish grandfather, in fact, who loved his wife so much, he almost told her. So, Junior, an amazing woman. So for me in those early days, Ron was intimidating. He had an encyclopedic mind and a razor tongue, but as the years went on, and we spent every single afternoon together, to say nothing of the countless dinners with June and Jenny, I discovered that Ron was really just a big, really smart Oreo cookie. He was hard and crunchy on the outside and warm and soft on the inside, and that inside was absolutely filled with love. And I'm going to take the last 2 minutes and just talk a little bit about that love. He had love for his sons, for his Ravens, certainly. You heard Jerry talking about that. For his friends, and don't forget his pets. Ron loved his pets, especially his dogs. Sometimes I thought that Ron loved pets more than people. But nowhere was that love more apparent than watching him with his beautiful wife, June. He said that the two of them would wake up every single morning, look at each other, and laugh. June made Ron smile, even at the very end. Humor sustained them. And to witness her strength, her grace, her dignity, her selfless love, knowing that every tick of the clock meant one step closer to the inevitable, it was extraordinary. For 9 weeks from his diagnosis to his passing, June got out of the house for a total of 6 hours. Also at his side were his three incredible boys, Ward, Andrew, and Christopher, and June's daughter, Amy. They were regal, regal, and made it possible for their father to die with dignity and with grace. Lastly, the constant and never-ending love from you all, from Ron's friends, from his audience, whether it was his WBAL family or dinners brought to him in the last days by the staff at Aldo's or the Oregon Grill or sit-downs with all the fellas out at the Humidor or the game ball that was given to him or the thousands upon thousands of emails and cards that he received. You were so kind to him, and I want to tell you that he really, really appreciated it. June called it card therapy. And when he was so weak to barely get up, they would sit and she would read him your cards. Now, in closing, I'm going to share something that I witnessed just days prior to his passing. Many people don't know this, but Ron was a very spiritual man. Organized religion might not have been his thing, but he knew that there was something out there that was greater than what we have right here. This was late in the game for Ron, a few days before he died. And I'm up at the house with Jenny, and I see Ron talking with Jenny in the living room, and he's standing there, and his eyes were closed, speaking to her. And he was describing his final visit with his healer, massage therapist Sebastian, who's amazing. Ron said, "I couldn't help it, but I started sobbing, not with sadness, but because something overwhelmed me." He asked Sebastian, "What was that?" Sebastian was also crying. And Sebastian replied, "That was everything." Ron opened his eyes and he looked at Jenny and me for a long time. And he said, "I felt myself becoming one with the cosmos, part of the universe." Then he looked at us and said, "When the lights go out, I think everything's going to be okay." He paused, smiled faintly, and said again, "Everything's going to be okay."